regional forecast. Your local radar showing any precipitation and its movement during the past 90 minutes. Intensity is indicated by the color code at the top of the screen.
The following program is part of Cable in the Classroom, a service of the cable television industry and your local cable company.
Channel, a special presentation. Flying in bad weather can strike fear into the heart of even the most seasoned traveler. Do airlines take the proper precautions when severe weather threatens? New technologies on the horizon will help aircraft avoid bad weather. But a newly discovered phenomenon may pose a threat to aircraft today. What new aviation dangers could come out of the blue?
Feet, 2 miles, you got the airplane.
5-0.
Ladies and gentlemen, the captain has turned on the fasten seatbelt sign in preparation for landing. Please check to see that your seatbelt is securely fastened and return all seats and tray tables to their upright and locked position.
We take so much for granted today, not the least of it, safe air travel. Travel by air was once a technological marvel. Now it's an everyday event, once a luxury, now a necessity. System lets us speak with anyone, anywhere, anytime. Computer networks provide access to information stored hundreds, even thousands of miles away. Along with all this comes a system of mass transportation that can take us to the other side of the planet in less time than it took our great grandparents to reach the other side of even the smallest American state. We assume we'll arrive safely and securely. Everything will work as it should. No breakdowns, no delays, no mistakes, no tragedies. But forces are at work that we have only recently come to understand. Winds, unseen, can cause a plane to drop hundreds of feet with almost no warning. Ice on an airplane's wings and fuselage, almost too thin to notice with the naked eye, can dangerously diminish its ability to fly. Perhaps most frightening, a newly recognized phenomenon that may be the aeronautic safety challenge of the 90s. Make no mistake, travel by air is by far the safest way to go. Compared to driving, flying seems positively risk-free. Aeronautical engineers have worked hard to make it so. But the story of how they worked to make air travel safer than ever before is a story with its roots in tragedy. Washington, D.C.'s National Airport. It's one of the busiest in the nation. And on January 13th, 1982, it became our most infamous.
That morning, we were supposed to go to Huntsville, Alabama. I was on a business trip with my boss. But there was 2 inches of snow that came through Huntsville, and they shut down the airport. So we rerouted our trip to St. Pete, Florida.
Because of the heavy snowfall, there was quite a buildup of traffic at Washington National Airport, and there was takeoff queue. And of course, the airplanes were being loaded with snow and ice. The de-icing is effective for a very short period of time, really. The airplane had been in the takeoff queue after it had been de-iced for some 49 minutes.
The snow continued, building on the plane's wings and fuselage. The transcript from the cockpit voice recorder now seems eerily prescient. The co-pilot, boy, this is a losing battle here on trying to de-ice those things. A false sense of security, that's all that does. The pilot responds, that satisfies the feds. Getting ice off the wings of an airplane and keeping it off is vital. As air travels over the wing, it flows in a pattern called laminar, or smooth. This creates a vacuum above the wing. Less air pressure above the wing, normal air pressure below the wing, causes the wing to rise. Lift is completely dependent on the shape of the wing. Even the slightest variation in shape, the sort of variation caused by ice, will cause the airflow to change from laminar to turbulent, nullifying the vacuum. Lift and lives depend on the shape of the wing. In addition, sensors on the outside of the airplane when covered with ice may not work as they're supposed to. A frozen sensor indicated the Air Florida jet had achieved takeoff speed. The sensor was wrong.
I noticed we were going down the runway very slow, slower than what you need to take off on a national. And I remember turning and looking out the window, and we were only at treetop level. I knew we weren't up real high, so I knew we weren't going to fall real far. I figured we were, again, going to land in the water. I forgot about the bridges. We slammed into the bridge. I just remember seeing black. My boss then grabbed my arm and said, Nikki, Nikki, and I said, wait, my seatbelt. And as soon as I said seatbelt, we were underwater. I just went up and then came up above the surface. And my boss was right next to me once I hit the surface. It was freezing cold. Did not think I was going to make it out of the water, so I started saying the Our Father, and I would say a sentence and then couldn't catch my breath, and Joe would say a sentence, so we kind of said it together every other sentence. And as soon as I said amen, the helicopter showed up, and I thought, oh, thank God.
Snowing quite hard, and when we got over real close, we could distinguish that there were actually six people there in the wreckage.
One by one, survivors were pulled to safety. To leave the river alive.
Nikki Welsh had two broken arms and couldn't hold on any longer, so we lost her halfway into shore. We decided to forego the rope. She wasn't going to be able to get up on that and stay up.
Gene Winter was yelling to me, give him my arm. And I raised my broken arm, and he grabbed it just above the break and pulled me up.
We just sat down right on the water surface with the skid, and I stepped out and picked her up, and away we went.
Seventy-eight people died, including four on the ground. Their cars rent ragged by the Air Florida jet as they sat in rush hour traffic on the 14th Street Bridge. Only five aboard the plane survived.
National Transportation Safety Board determines that the probable cause of this accident was the flight crew's failure to use engine anti-ice during ground operation and takeoff. Their decision to take off with snow ice on the airfoil surfaces of the airport.
At the National Center for Atmospheric Research, or NCAR, in Boulder, Colorado, scientists are working to ensure that what happened to Air Florida Flight 90 never happens again. Two leaders in this research are Roy Rasmussen and Marsha Polatovich.
I think the thinness of the ice is a problem, and it hasn't been that well known until the past few years that that thin of an ice thickness would cause as much of a degradation in performance as it does. Just a millimeter of ice can reduce the lift and drag by 25%. How do we detect it now? Currently, we don't detect it. The pilot essentially looks out the window and tries to determine if there's any ice on the wing. If he has any question, he is allowed to go back and get the aircraft de-iced.
All out!
Thousands of miles away, scientists at Boeing Corporation work on a related problem, that of ice accumulating on the wings of a plane in flight.
In-flight icing doesn't usually receive the press that the ground icing cases do because it involves more of the general aviation or commuter aircraft. And, two to five, small numbers of people at a time are killed as a result, and that usually doesn't make the headlines quite so much. But when you add up the totals, it ends up at about 40 people per year, and that's been fairly steady over the last 10 years.
In Boeing's icing wind tunnel in Seattle, a new computer program predicts how ice will form on a wing under various icing conditions. The wing is then exposed to those conditions in the tunnel to see if the program is accurate. If the computer program is valid, it can be used to predict the type and the extent of icing under almost any conditions, enabling researchers to test wing designs, anti-icing devices, and de-icing methods without ever flying a plane or entering a wind tunnel. But perhaps the most prudent approach is avoidance. To that end, Rasmussen, Polatovich, and others at NCAR have developed the Aviation Weather Products Generator. This remarkable new technology allows pilots to plot their course, see the terrain they'll encounter on their flight, shown here in red, along with the altitudes at which icing will be encountered, seen here in blue. If icing is expected, the pilot can take steps to avoid it, change his flight path or altitude, and the information is updated constantly. Back on the ground, the technology to get airplanes ice-free and keep them ice-free exists today. The de-icing fluids in common use are effective for a known length of time. Doppler radar can see snow bands as they approach the airport, so a pilot can simply stay at the gate when heavy snow is approaching. But solving the problem of ground de-icing is more complex. At its core is a factor less reliable, less predictable, man. In the crucial 30 minutes before takeoff, it's up to the pilot to demand another de-icing if he feels his situation could prove dangerous. Sometimes, a look out the cockpit window simply isn't enough. Texas. The city sits like a shimmering jewel, a resplendent emblem of the new West, prosperity, sunshine, an unlimited future. Even the weather here seems somehow bigger. Summer thunderstorms light up the sky, bringing with them drenching rains, battering hail, tornadoes. Any severe weather America gets, Dallas probably gets worse, or at least claims to. One thing Dallas can claim is plenty of deadly wind shear.
Wind shear has been defined in many different ways, but a practical working definition would be a rapid change in wind magnitude and or direction. The most studied and perhaps the most famous category of wind shifts, as they pose aviation hazards, it's called a microburst. Small downdraft of air rapidly descending toward the ground, hitting, spreading out in all directions, much like you would see when you, if you pointed a water hose on concrete.
The effect can be startling. This house in Oklahoma was hit by a downburst in September of 1993. To the untrained eye, this could easily be mistaken for tornado damage. What would cause the wind to move straight down with such ferocity?
It has to do with negative buoyancy. Just as a hot air balloon rises because of buoyancy, a cool bubble of air will fall because of negative buoyancy. Heavy rain comes out of the thunderstorm, and the air within that heavy rain is much cooler than the warm, humid air around it. This negative buoyancy allows that bubble of air to accelerate downward faster and faster until it hits the ground and spreads out in all directions as a strong wind gust.
While all degrees of wind shear can be dangerous to aircraft, the most severe ones, microbursts, can be especially deadly. Think of the water hose analogy, a stream heading straight down, then spreading out in all directions. As an aircraft nears the storm, it first encounters headwinds. Logic tells us flying into the wind would cause the plane to slow down. It actually increases lift as air passes over the wings at a greater speed. In response, the pilot will often cut power and point the nose of the craft down in order to maintain altitude. But next, the plane encounters a sudden downdraft that literally pushes the plane down. If the pilot has cut power in response to the initial headwinds, it will take 8 to 10 precious seconds to restore full power.
Wind shear.
What's more, at the same time, airspeed over the wing decreases, reducing lift. Tailwinds on the other side of the downburst may strike the finishing blow. Airspeed over the wings drops precipitously, thus reducing lift to zero. When an aircraft is flying low and slow, when taking off or landing, the effect can be disastrous. The tale of one such disaster begins and ends in Dallas, Texas. On a stormy afternoon in July of 1982, the crew of Delta Airlines Flight 191 did everything right, but still could not escape tragedy. A warning. What follows may be upsetting to some viewers. This animation was created by the National Transportation Safety Board. The voices you hear are from the actual cockpit voice recorder. Just a few minutes out from Dallas, the clouds that are approaching look ominous. Moments later, the first effects of the storm. Suddenly, the plane hits the center of the downburst, and all lift gone, it drops to only 50 feet from the ground. A moment later, impact. Dallas that July afternoon, 43 passengers and crew dead, two more killed on the ground. Only five passengers survived the crash of Delta 191. Dr. Roland Bowles knows the effect of wind shear firsthand. As head of NASA's Airborne Wind Shear Detection Program, he has flown hundreds of missions into severe storms in an effort to learn how pilots can detect and avoid microbursts. Whether on the ground or aloft, he gathers data only under strictly controlled conditions.
We have done a great deal of simulator studies looking at how much advance warning is enough. That was a very critical design issue, because whereas there's technology today that will alert pilots to the fact that they are already experiencing a wind shear performance loss, we felt the dividends to be derived from advance warning were much preferable.
Simulators are an essential tool to those who may someday face wind shear. In this state-of-the-art computer-controlled environment, a pilot can fly through a virtual world that is almost indistinguishable from the real world. Programmed with flight data from jets that actually flew through a microburst, the simulator allows a pilot to experience all the effects of wind shear.
Wind shear, wind shear, wind shear.
But here, no lives are at stake, only pride.
We did a substantial simulator program over many years. We found that as much as 15, 20, 30 seconds of advance warning was more than adequate to deal with the problem.
The question then, how to provide that warning?
NASA was asked by the FAA to address the whole area of airborne detection and warning of hazardous wind shear conditions. That is technology on the airplane that could provide advance warning of the presence of hazardous wind shear conditions and provide alerts to pilots with enough time so the crew could avoid or escape from the encounter. And as a result of that, NASA has developed three instrument technologies that we thoroughly evaluated in a two-year field flight program, both at Denver Stapleton Airport and Orlando International Airport. The specific technologies were an advanced pulse Doppler radar, a pulse Doppler laser, or LIDAR, and a passive infrared radiometer.
During the testing phase, sensors both on the ground and onboard the aircraft direct Dr. Bowles and his associates to the very center of the downburst. Why purposely fly into such a dangerous event? As we just learned, the aim is to warn pilots when they're about to enter a downburst. The sensors developed by Dr. Bowles and his associates appear to provide that warning. But the only way to verify that what the sensors tell you is correct is to fly into a downburst.
Hey, we're going to take it right now.
Okay, take it straight ahead.
225 air.
Going down to 9.
Okay, I'm showing 9 knots, 10 knots on the tail right now.
Watch the upper left
the right.
Quadrant.
The, right.
The red dot means they've hit the downburst.
Good. Target's about a mile and a half. 0.13.
We may be getting a little
good heading. Good heading right there.
Performance increase.
Okay, yeah. Came around to 7 knots on the nose. Went from 10 on the tail to 7 on the nose. Ground speeds, 2.31.
Pretty moderate rain. There's a little decrease.
There, the wind's going around the tail again. 10 knots, 12 knots.
We saw that.
That's a good one, and we lost some altitude there, too.
And we got a 0.15.
And we're still getting a decrease.
Good. 0.65.
Devin had a good strong downdraft right in the middle of it.
Yeah,
just sunk 100 feet just in almost no time at all.
From the experimental to the practical, scientists at the National Center for Atmospheric Research are applying this innovative technology to the commercial aviation industry.
Aviation weather hazards have been a problem ever since the Wright brothers began their first flight. Actually, the first flight encountered wind shear. So wind shear back at the early days and continuing today is still a big problem. But what we have in this laboratory are a number of display systems that are being designed to bring aviation weather to pilots, air traffic controllers, flight service specialists.
One such system, perhaps the most remarkable, is the 3D Terminal Viewer, a real-time virtual image generator that offers pilots and controllers a computer-generated view of their immediate environment. It uses the same technologies Dr. Bowles once carried aloft, pulse Doppler radar for detecting heavy rain, pulse Doppler laser for detecting dry air movement, and passive infrared radiometer for detecting the cold air that forms a downdraft. This is Stapleton International Airport in Denver, seen from the point of view of a commercial aircraft on final approach. The gray areas indicate heavy rain. The red areas are microbursts. Even their computer image looks dangerous. Before landing, a pilot can simulate his approach to the assigned runway, in effect, make a test run while the computer shows him what he'll encounter along the way. He can simulate approach to another runway or from another direction. From the control tower, an air traffic controller may see nothing but dark clouds. But the 3D terminal viewer sees through the clouds, clearly identifying cells of heavy rain, downbursts, and more. Here's the computer's view from the tower. North, south, east, west.
The current aviation weather systems that are in the country today are based on technologies that are at least 10 years old. They show very low resolution information. The information is often not very timely. You may have depictions of where thunderstorms are that's an hour and a half old. You don't have information today in specific altitudes where icing and turbulence is. So what we're trying to develop is very high resolution information for icing and turbulence and all the weather hazards, make them available right away, and make them available to the end user right away, in the cockpit, to the pilot, to the controller, without any delays. The current air traffic control system is very reactive. If you give the right information to all of the users, they can plan your route of flight to avoid the hazardous weather rather than react to it once you encounter it or once you approach it.
Air Shuttle 7543, hold short of runway 26 right, turn right at Charlie 6 or Charlie 5.
With the latest technology soon in place around the country, and with the type of advanced training available today, already we've seen vast advances in safety. And with onboard wind shear detection systems in all transport carriers, the planes flown by the airlines, mandated as of December 1995, the problem once posed by microbursts may already be a thing of the past.
Between 1970 and 1985, there were 17 accidents or so involving air carrier airplanes that were attributed to a wind shear or a microburst encounter. Seven of those were fatal, and there were 575 deaths attributed to the wind shear phenomena. Since 1985, we have not had one fatal accident involving a large air carrier airplane in this country that's been attributed to the wind shear.